Know what? I think it's time to crack out a little story from one of my old characters, who was dealing with a fuckwit like your paladin. Me, paladin, and other PCs, CN herps of various flavours mostly. All of them so dark and edgy. Now we were mercs in a huge age-old war setting. We'd just captured a city, mostly through my efforts as general. The other PCs were revving it up to lord it over the whole city. They were cleaning their thumbscrews, polishing their bell ends, and preparing rope to enslave the children. One of them had his eye on the wife of the noble who ran the city, and I quote here, was going to make her moan like a whore for her husband slowing us down. Might have been because she shot him and took him down to -3 with her bow when he went up to do diplomacy and acted like a fucktard. My character was well aware of their intentions, and the fact that his own side wouldn't punish them for it. And the longer he held them off, the worse it would be if they got to the prisoners. His reaction, she turned to them as the first rocks were loaded and spoke through his armor. If you kill a man, kill him with dignity he deserves. Take him face to face if you can. If not, then use as little trickery as you can. Let all know you fought him in single, fair battle if you did, so none may claim foul play. If you respect him, hold him as he dies and hear his last words, so you may pass them on to whoever they are for. If you fear him, then check that he is gone and that it is a sure thing. If he is a good man, let him die quick and clean. If he is alone, bury him. If he is family, let them know and understand why you fought and tell them his last words. If he has a wife, do not harm her or force yourself upon her. If he has a child, do not let them see their father fall. If he has power, then before the fight, make sure that all know your intention and why you must bring him to task. Only through treating our enemy with respect can we avoid feuds with the family, being hunted by black widows we thought we had killed, or children who watched their fathers die by your hand and their home ruined. Only this way can we avoid the spirits of past and regret and our fallen foes from coming back to us again and again. Now, for some reason, they found this hilarious. The idea there could be honor in war, in battle, and that your enemies deserved respect. The other players were almost rolling on the floor when I sat there, blank-faced, waiting for their PCs to agree to treat the prisoners with dignity. Finally, one of them who was working as a spy for the kingdom, keeping an eye on my character, who was too just to be a powerful figure in the LA Empire and too popular just to kill off, spat in my face, well, helmet, and told me that he was basically unofficially in charge and said he and the others would do what they liked and there wasn't a thing I could do about it. If I didn't like it, I would be gone within hours, dead, and someone who would let them have their sport would replace me. I stared at him, silent and stone-faced, for a good 30 seconds. That shit-eater grin on his face remained for the first 20, but then slowly started to fade as he realized I wasn't going to agree. He reached for his dice, ready to roll initiative, and I decided on the only right thing to do. My character turned to his messenger, a mid-level illusionist who was working as his personal assistant and was tanked up with a huge mass spell-casting items, and said 5 words: "Kill them all, no prisoners." Then I rode to the forefront, leaving the other PCs stunned to silence to wait out the battle as. Though they might have reveled in the aftermath, not one of them had the balls for a real fight. Fair fight. Reached the castle first, and after killing their general in hand-to-hand combat and swearing I would do what was best for his family, offered his wife poison, which she took, and took the sword to the children myself. The other players, who were all pricks, were all sitting there, pale-faced and horrified as the GM described the blood in the streets, the piles of soldiers' bodies, the chaos and slaughter, all of them finally screaming, "I couldn't do this. It was monstrous." As I described entering the children's bedroom, sword in hand and firm in my intentions, at which point I fucking turned on them, calling them on their horseshit, that what I was doing at least treated those who fought with us with some respect, letting them die rather than weeks, months of agony, humiliation, and shame. By the time I was done, none of them could look me in the eye. I described the scene they must be seeing from the hill we had set up camp on, the screaming and clashing of swords in the wind, the smell of blood so thick it called for fort saves. The true horror of war, on a plate, delivered right to their doorstep. as my paladin committed genocide on an entire people without hesitation because they gave him no other choice. Their uncomfortable glances as they all tried to work out which one of them was most to blame. The entire city below them, aflame as my character torched the wooden houses and left one of the enemy's greatest cities as a charred, hollow, gutted mess that no man would set camp in again. The looks on their faces as I hit the blood-stained tabard and then knelt down and gently introduced myself as your father's good friend. He asked me to put you to bed tonight. To the two daughters, and the sun was magnificent, a thing of beauty. At that point, I turned back to the GM and said simply, my character leads the slaughter personally, down to the last. The entire city burns that night, because he believed it was better to let people die with dignity they and their months of resistance had earned, than to hand them into the maws of monsters and the hands of fucking degenerates, looking straight at the spy. Now this tale teaches us three good lessons, two of which can apply to OP. Firstly, as a paladin, you do the right thing, even if it isn't pleasant. Know what? Leaving her dead isn't a happy ending for her, but it was the right thing to do, because she's still a danger to everyone while she lives, and because you treat your enemies with respect they deserve. You don't let your little holy avenger do thinking for you. You're meant to be better than that. You're a warrior of justice. Sometimes justice isn't nice, and fuck you. Rape is never acceptable as a paladin. Slap your other player's shit for trying it on. He can capture her, he can tie her up, he can even threaten to punish her in the name of redemption. But it's difficult, and defeating her in combat and then having her there and then is more barbarian than paladin. Tell him that some dude who plays paladin a lot on the internet thinks he's a fucking disgrace to the name and should fall right now for his actions. He bred hate in her. Now you cannot subdue an enemy using your dick. Second, people who act like cuckfuckles need to be dealt with by handing them the rope. By fear and having a firm hand, you teach them once, hard. You remind them that while they can be gritty and 9-inch nails as fuck, but there is nothing in the world more dangerous than someone who's got a purpose beyond themselves. Your paladin was indulging himself. That's not a paladin. You need to get a firmer handle on the bastard. Same with the girl who's going to cause trouble. If someone acts like a complete asshole, you bring them back in line. Give someone like that an inch and they'll take a fucking mile. Players have to be reminded their actions have consequences. If you're a GM or a player, either way, you can call them out in their faggotry. You cut them off at the start of the next session. You bring them into line. You call him out on what he did to the tiefling and tell him he can't be trusted. If he resists, you kill him because he's too unreliable and unprofessional to let live and to be a real soldier. After all, he left you all to die so he could go play dick demon, rather than covering your backs. He'd probably turn on you in a moment if the right person lifted her skirt an inch or two. You take the tiefling and you give her two options, a gas of redemption under your protection or a clean cut death. Then whatever she chooses, you give it to her. Lastly, and most important of all the things to learn from this story, though not relevant here, illusionists capable of big ass magic that can trick even the strongest minds or create illusions that last for months, years, make fucking fantastic friends and useful brothers in arms. And creating a place where no one dares to go is often enough to hide something fairly large and still standing, if it's out of the way. Only after our God King himself appeared on the battlefield and ordered me to butcher an entire surrendered people. When we were about 2,000 miles from where the city was, and about 2,500 miles from the heartland of our newly much larger empire. By that point, I was the marshal and the entire army was under my command. I was known as the Shield and was the most respected general in the history of the kingdom. At which point I turned on him with Smite Evil, killing the decadent fucker in one swing, my 10,000 hardcore supporters joining me instantly in revolution, and a legion of the damned emerged from the burned city, having been put together under my very subtle directions, under the banner of the dead Baron, came marching out and conquered the capital overnight. By this point, most of the other PCs had developed into decent-ish people. The massacre had been a turning point for them, putting what they had done into context. Those that weren't died there and then, with dignity. And the Empire fell neatly under my command. Marshal, King, leader who I had refused to let pass on, and all-around big bad evil guy tier monster, according to public legend. Took a long time to get my PR back up, but I created an empire that lasted 1,000 generations and was worth fighting to protect. The first empire in the setting that wasn't a terrible place, ran by dickholes. All in all, good end for the people.